Ayana.
The Veda chanting which has been going on in the morning and in the evening, as Bhagwan comes out of his residence and walks towards Kulwant Hall, the auditorium, students start chanting Veda. The chanting of Veda may appear to be just noise, just some voice or some loud sound, meaningless shouts. But my friends, it is not so. Vedas contain slokas, S-L-O-K-A-S. The slokas are in Sanskrit language. They are not composed by any man. They are born out of intuition from within. Among the saints who spent years and years in penance there in forests long back, and they got some intuitive feeling and they started memorizing,
and that knowledge is passed on from one generation to another generation. The very sound of Veda has got an effect on our brain. The electromagnetic waves of Vedas have got effect on our nervous system, circulatory system, blood circulation and all that. Veda helps us individually for at the physical level, at the mental level and at the spiritual level. Veda chanting also helps the entire community to grow, and a sort of a prayer to ensure timely rain, that the country may prosper, that the country may be full of plenty and prosperity. Veda prays for the welfare of the entire humanity, not of a country, not of a region, not of a religion, certainly not. It prays for the entire humanity, for the whole universe. Veda has got nothing to do with the religion. With those few words, I'll proceed with the rest of the details. You are quite welcome to put questions if you have any towards the end. My friends, let me tell you that there are around 300 universities in this country with 40 lakhs of students on rolls getting higher education out of these colleges and universities. But I can tell you one thing, if there is any single university where the teaching of culture, the teaching of values is the center, is the main theme, it is none other than Sri Satya Sai University. I am telling you the fact, they will be confirmed slowly as you listen to my other talks, because they contain statements made by eminent educationists from all parts of this country that we'll come to know in due course of time. In other words, it is enough if we know right now that Sri Satya Sai University is the only university in this country which focuses its attention on the cultural values, the tradition of this country. And the second point which I want to draw your attention is this. As you must be watching there, all students know Veda chanting. Right from kindergarten level, KG child, to PhD student, all students chant Veda in unison. They join in chorus, in perfect harmony, excellent diction, beautiful pronunciation, ideal modulation, full-throated, with joy, hours together. is not an easy joke. To teach Veda to all thousands of children, so that they all sing the glory of God, praying for the whole of the humanity, for the mankind, such that the humanity will live in peace, security, safety, prosperity. Well, that's something great, something unique of this institution. Apart from that, one thing that we don't find anywhere is this. Girls chanting Veda, which is an exception. Usually in this country, women in earlier days were prohibited from learning Veda. Later they protested, people are ready to teach, but no one is ready to learn. So Vedic knowledge is not very popular among women. But it is Sri Satya Sai Baba who made all girls of Anantapur chant Veda, which I am not able to believe even now, though I have been listening to it for the last 14 years. Is it all true? That's what I feel every time I hear girls chanting Veda there. Here in this country, there are priests who perform various rituals, spiritual rituals, activities like marriages, learning, housewarming function, naming the child. These are all the religious activities which are all performed by priests, as you know that. And all priests are supposed to know Veda. But believe me or not, the standard of Veda chanting of our students is of professional standard. I even joke with them, "Arey boys, you don't have to worry about unemployment. You can live as a priest as well." The boys, usually, well, I'm not a very serious man, no, by temperament. And I don't also mix with serious people. And I take that religion is bliss. I believe that God is bliss. And I know seriousness is a sign of sickness and not of spirituality. So I like smiling people and I make people smile. And when boys say, "Sir, we know this, we chant all this," I tell them, "Boys, I appreciate you for another reason. Priests outside, they chant Veda as a means of livelihood, to earn their bread. But you blokes, you fellows, you are PhDs and M.Tech, M.Sc.s and PG boys chanting Veda. I think you are first-class enemies of all priestly class there in the country." Because they have that kind of excellence, I tell you. The intonation, the modulation, the throat, oh, wow, as if, supposing you take this cassette and make any pandit, a scholar in Veda, listen to that, he will say, "He must have been from a very high ranking university where Veda is taught." Unbelievable standard. That also I want to bring to your attention. My friends, we worship what for? To enjoy the blessings of God. We pray why? To get the blessings of God. We meditate. Why? To see the manifestation of God. We sing bhajans. Why? To see God in front of us. So all our spiritual activities are to enjoy the manifestation of God. This Veda chanting in front of God Himself is something fantastic. A lifetime fulfillment. Because those people who chant Veda outside, to see God, whereas you see Him and chant His glory in front of Him, it is really double the profit. Double the profit. Which is not an easy thing. And our God also wants all of us to know how great His children are. Naturally, God, when He takes human form, He too will have certain humanistic tendencies. He wants the whole world to know that all students are experts in Veda and that it is not the monopoly of couple of students. You must have watched there. Suddenly you will ask all college boys to stop. And he asks high school students to start. You'll all know that. High school students also know that. Suddenly you will stop them. He will ask elementary school people to start chanting. By that we all come to know that all children of Sai education institutions are very well versed, very familiar with the Veda and its chanting. Not only that, he started playing some games. He wants one boy to stop, another boy to take from then, continue from there, stop, another boy, you continue from there, something like a chain. So you should start where the other boy stops. The next man should start where you stop, so that it will be something like chain. So that chanting is not mechanical, that chanting is an art of perfection. That chanting is an art of perfection, not mere memorization, no. So he wants boys to do that also, which is a kind of revelation to all of us, about which we are extremely happy. One day, suddenly, stop. He asked somebody, "Do you know the meaning of Veda?" He said, "Yes, Swami." All right. All right, boys, start. One stanza, stop. You tell the meaning. In English. He started giving the English meaning of that verse. Stop. Next verse. So, verse after verse. In between, English translation. Please don't misunderstand me if I say, a fact is a fact. Most of the pundits also do not know the meaning of Veda. Point 0.1% of Indians also do not know Veda nor its meaning. But it's unbelievable how they could give English meaning verse after verse and all that. So to chant Veda itself is sufficient achievement, and to know its meaning is an accomplishment, which is unique. That's what I have seen. The climax of this is this. One day suddenly he asked one lecturer, "Come here. You ask these boys some questions on Veda. Even to prepare question paper, the teacher needs at least 3 to 4 hours of time. He should assemble all his books, see the syllabus, previous year question paper, and prepare the question paper. But here is our good God, who suddenly asks one lecturer to put questions on Veda. He is caught unaware. He doesn't know. Boys do not know that they are going to be examined. That too in front of thousands of devotees. If they flop, if they cut a sorry figure, Swami will feel let down very much. When he is so proud of his university, when he is so proud of his students, if at all students are to fail, he will feel let down. But God never fails. God never fails. So to demand, he asked that lecturer, "Come on, put some questions." Please believe me, all questions are highly informative. And the answers are excellent. No one failed. Claps, cheers like anything. Most of you must have watched the whole scene that day. I noted those questions and answers for the benefit of English speaking people. Some Sanskrit verses are here, the language which I myself do not know. So for convenience sake, I have written in Telugu, my mother tongue. which I made it in English Roman script, which will get into the website, that will be duly supplied by the courtesy of our friends. But I'll give you some questions which are interesting. Questions are put by a lecturer on the dais in Thai Kulwant Hall, open to the thousands of public, and questions are put to students. Any student can get up and give the answer. You must have seen that. All of them are unprepared. To me it appeared as if it is a public oral examination, an open viva voce, an examination conducted like that. Question 1. There is some portion of Veda chanting what is called Rudram, R-U-D-R-A-M, Rudram. And this Rudram has got two parts. One is Namakam, the other is Chamakam. The question is this: boys, you have learnt Rudram, and this Rudram has two parts, Namakam and Chamakam. What is the difference between the two? Because we elders do not know, so the question doesn't arise. But one boy got up and said, Swami, I'll give the answer. Yes, what is the answer? Chamakam part satisfies your desires. Chamakam part of the chanting of Veda will help for the fulfillment of your desires, whatever you ask for. Therefore, all mantras of this Chamakam part end with the two letters, Chame, 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 Chame. You must have heard it there. Chame means, I want that, I want that, I want that. Therefore, Chamakam is the submission of desires and you get them fulfilled. The other part is Namakam. What is Namakam? The Namakam part of this Rudram is surrender to God. Here there are two letters, Na, Ma. Na, Ma, two letters. Ma, mine, Na, not mine. Clear? Ma, mine, Na, not, not mine, everything is yours. You understand? So, submission to God, surrender to God, that nothing is mine, everything is yours, is the meaning of Na, Ma, Namakam. I think I am clear. Therefore, Namakam, Chamakam. The interesting is, in Namakam, the first letter is Na. In Chamakam, the second letter is Ma. Na, Ma, meaning egolessness, not mine. That is the meaning explained by boys. Swami was very, very happy, as it is very well noticeable on the face. The second question is this. There is one sloka which says that everything is full in this world. Everything is full. Nothing is a fragment. Nothing is a bit. No, everything is full. The whole is full. You are full. Everything full. Particularly in respect of quality, we will understand the fullness. The question is this. Which sloka from Upanishads say that everything is total, everything is full, and that divinity is full, this universe is full, full minus full again full, full plus full is full? Because we are fools, we don't understand what fullness is. That is full, this is full. Zero minus zero, zero. Zero plus zero, zero. Zero into zero, zero. That's all, simple mathematics. So that is infinite, this is infinite, that is full, this is full. Which sloka says that? Boys, one boy gave the answer. Purnamada purnamidam. Purnat purnamudachyate. Purnasya purnamadaya. Purnamevavasishyate. That is the sloka which is given over there. Third question. How do you say that is full? That means divinity. This is full. That means humanity. How do you say that? Cite one example given by Baba in support of this. That is the question put in. You must say, what's there? One smart fellow got up and said, yes. You go to the shop and buy jaggery. You know jaggery? Right? Yes, big lump like the jaggery. And you want to make some sweet out of it. What do you do? Out of that big bond, you cut a piece. Right? Out of this piece, you cut still smaller piece and make use of the material to make some sweet rice pudding or pie or donut, whatever you call it. Now, the point is, the piece of jaggery which you used is as sweet as the mass that you have. The mass of jaggery is as sweet as the whole lot of jaggery. Am I clear? That is the example given by Baba as answered well by student. So, that is total, this is total. One bag of sugar is as sweet as one bottle of sugar. One bottle of sugar has got as much of sweetness as the spoon of sugar. Is it not? No, spoon of sugar has little sweetness. Bottle has more sweetness. Bag is all full. Nobody would say that. So far as the sweetness is concerned, spoon is as much as the bottle of sugar. The bottle of sugar is as much as the bag of sugar. In respect of the quality, that's what it is. Question number 4. What is the meaning of Upanishad? Yes, answer. Upa meaning near. Ni, down. Shat, sit. Sit down near. Sit down near. So Upanishad meaning the student should sit down near the teacher. This may not be acceptable to Western students. Why? Why should I sit down? I want to sit on the head of my teacher. Why? Equal rights. Why after all? Why not? But the idea behind is this. Teacher sits at a higher level and student at a lower level, meaning the knowledge will flow downwards. Water flows downward. Similarly, knowledge also will flow downward. And the boy said the same point. Upanishad meaning sit down here. That's what we are doing here. Swami is sitting on the stage. We sit on the ground. So it is Upanishad. That's what is going on today. Every day in the presence of Swami, everybody liked the answer. Then there is another portion. That what they chant every day, it is called Purusha Suktam. Purusha Suktam, meaning everything in praise of God, the divinity, His greatness, His uniqueness, His glory, His vastness, His splendor. So, the attributes of God, all that is described in Purusha Suktam. The question is this, what is the relevance of Purusha Suktam in the modern society? If anyone starts chanting Veda on the road, we think something has gone wrong with his mind. Purusha Suktam, what has got to do with the modern society? Man landing on the moon, computer. Why? What is its application? One boy gave the answer, quoting from Swami's discourse. Man is the limb of the society. Society is the limb of the nature. Nature is the limb of divinity. So, a man and God are related. Part of God is nature, part of nature is society, part of society is man. So, the relationship between man, society, nature and God is very well explained in Purusha Sutta, which means that they are interdependent and interlinked. They are interlinked, interconnected, interdependent and interrelated. This is what Purusha Sutta means. The modern society requires the interrelationships now more than ever before, because we are divided on silly considerations. We are divided on considerations about which we feel ashamed of. So this, for unity, we need to study Purusha Sutta today. That's what he said. Further, you must have heard of caste system in India. You must have heard of it. Unfortunately, the caste system, very unfortunately, is politicized, is used by politicians to their advantage, is used by the rulers in those days, foreign rulers, to divide the country so that they could rule for a long period of time. India was under the foreign rule because of the caste system, which was exploited by the rulers in those days. But the original concept is different. This sloka speaks what it is. There are four castes. First caste, Brahmin. He represents the head of God. Second, Kshatriya, the warrior class. They represent the shoulders. And three, Vaishya, V-Y-S-Y-A, business class, represents the stomach. Four, Sudra, S-U-D-R-A, agricultural labor, feet. Are the same body. Can there be body without the head? Can there be body without the feet? Can there be the body without the hands? So all the castes are compared to the limbs of the same God. But unfortunately, people thought they are different, and they got themselves divided, and the country became weak. Even now, politics play game, taking advantage of the caste system in the society. But the original design, caste system, is based on the temperament, profession and vocation, avocation, temperament, attitude to life. Brahmins, they are supposed to be priestly class. They are supposed to take care of spiritual pursuits, spiritual needs of society. Kshatriyas, army, they are supposed to protect the country. Vaishya, they are supposed to take care of business, ministers of commerce and industries. Sudras, they are supposed to take care of grain, food, agriculture. Tell me who is important and who is unimportant. Can you say that? No. That's the original idea as explained by this boy. Next. In Upanishad, in one Upanishad, there is a small portion, what we call Bhruguvalli. Bhruguvalli. The question is this. What is it that Bhruguvalli conveys? The answer given one boy is this. Bhrugu, B-H-R-U-G-U, is the name of a saint. As a boy, to know God, he did his own penance, his own attempt, and went to his father, who himself is a great saint. He asked him, "Oh father, who is God? Let me know. Father said, you go and investigate. You do some penance. You do certain spiritual activity. Meditate. You will know the answer. And the boy returns. He said, Father, I have found out who God is. Oh, did you? Yes. Who is God? Food is God, he said. Oh, food is God? Yes, my son. You need to know little more. Go and meditate further. The boy goes to the forest once again, meditated for some time, and returns. Father, I have known who God is this time. Oh, son, good. Who is God? Life is God. So from food, he has evolved to the state of life. Life is God. Then father said, son, you need to know little more. Better you go. The boy went and did penance for some more time, for some more years, and returned, Father, I have known some more details of God. Oh, son, it's so nice. Who is God now? Mind is God. Oh, mind is God? Oh, you need to know some more details. Better you go. The fellow went and did penance this time and returned, Father, I have known. Oh, I say, what do you have known? Bliss is God. Then father said, you arrived at the end. This is the state. So the investigation, the inquiry of God begins with food. We think food is God at one time. Later, life is God. And a later time, we begin to understand the mind is God. Later, we will understand the spirit is God, vijnana. And finally, we will come to know that bliss is God, which is the end of it. This is the summary of Bhrguvalli as answered by that student on that day. Question number 7. Veda taught the way to immortality. And Veda said that there is only one way to immortality. What is that way? The sloka is given there. I'll convey the meaning. The only way to immortality is awareness of the self. Awareness of the self. Experience of the self. By the path of inquiry takes you to the state of immortality. That's what boy said. And this knowledge of the self was first revealed to Indra, Indra, by Brahma himself. And later it has come down to earth and to the people. And today, my friends, forgetting the all that deals with ancient literature and all that, epics, I am not speaking about it. But what is important for us right now is the path of self-inquiry, which is most essential for every one of us. In the modern society, it is not possible to spend time in penance for a long time. It is not possible to do rituals like yagas and yajnas today. We do not have eligible, qualified, experienced people to do these spiritual rites today. The modern technical scientific mind does not accept the old methods. But self-inquiry is the method which we have to follow today, which is the only path to immortality. Question number 8. What is the use of Veda chanting? Why? We can have Swami Darshan. Why these fellows go on shouting like that? Why Veda chanting loudly? Why? What is the benefit? 2 points. As they chant, you hear. Those that hear, those that chant will have 2 benefits. What are they? One, they atone their sins. All the sins are forgiven. no due certificate. He can atone your sins. Number two, divinity is experienced. Divinity is experienced. That is the second purpose of Veda chanting. Question number nine. Towards the end of bhajans, we hear these three. Asatoma sadgamaya tamasoma jyotirgamaya mrutyorma amrutangamaya. Father, lead us from untruth to truth, from darkness to light, from death to immortality is the meaning. Yes. These three are from which Upanishad? That is the question. The answer from a boy, high school boy, this is from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. There are 108 Upanishads. Of them, Dvadasha, 12, are very popular Upanishads. Among them, Brihadaranyaka is one, and these three are taken from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Am I clear, please? You follow me? Yes. And then comes next question. Sikshavalli is a part of one Upanishad. What is its ultimate teaching? The answer. The ultimate teaching of Sikshavalli, a portion of Upanishad, is this. Speak truth, follow righteousness. Satyam vada, dharman chara. Speak truth, follow dharma, the righteous conduct. In humility and with love. In humility, with love. That is the ultimate message of Sikshavalli, a portion of Upanishads. Question number 11. Vedas are also called Apaurusheya. Apaurusheya is another name given to Vedas. Why? Answer. Since they are not composed by a human being, that they are all the revelations heard by intuition. And the sages and seers could get this intuition because of deep penance, renunciation, total dedication for the humanity, for the welfare of the humanity. Therefore, Vedas are called Apaurusheya. Question number 12. Three books, all the three sacred texts, they are called Prasthanatraya. Prasthanatraya. What are those three books? Brahma Sutra, Bhagavad Gita, Upanishad. All these three sacred texts are together called Prasthanatraya. That is the answer. Question number 13. Brahma Sutra is one among those three. What did Swami say about Brahma Sutra? What are Swami's views about this book, Brahma Sutra? Simple. For all the apparent world, there is a hidden principle of divinity. Just like there are flowers in a garland and the thread which passes through all these flowers, making it a beautiful garland. And the thread which is not seen, while the flowers are seen openly. So Brahma Sutra, Sutra is the thread, Brahma is the divinity, bringing together the flowers, the of creation. Am I clear? That's what Bhagavan said. Then, next question. You must have heard it. Aditya Varnam Tamasah Parastat Vedaha Vedam Purusham Mahantam Aditya Varnam Tamasah Parastat. I don't know, because repeatedly hearing, few things got into my head. don't think that I'm expert of all that, I know all that. Please, please don't mistake me like that. I'm very plain in this matter. Now, how did saints view the divinity? Well, what is their view? What is their vision? That is the question. Aditya Varna, meaning brilliance, radiance, splendor, illumination, tamasaha, darkness, parastat, beyond. Am I clear? Beyond the darkness, there is effulgence, there is light, that is divinity. Meaning, darkness is ignorance, effulgence is self-awareness. That is the answer. Then, question number 15. Vedas are only four, but there is one book which is called Panchama Veda, the fifth Veda. That book is given the status of Veda, though it is not Veda. Vedas are only four, but there is another book which is given status, almost. Fifth Veda, what is it? Panchama Veda. Answer. The great epic Mahabharata. Pandavas, Kauravas, all that. That is called the fifth Veda. That is the answer. Question number 16. Why is it called fifth Veda? Why? The answer, simple. What all that is present in the world is there in Mahabharata. Whatever is not mentioned here is not present anywhere. Political, ethical, moral, spiritual, all aspects of life are dealt in all thoroughness and in depth in Mahabharata. And whatever that is not seen here is nowhere else. So it is given the status of Veda. That is the 16th question. 17th question. There is one mantra which is repeated. Praying for long life. Ordinary people take this way to be immortal, to conquer death. Mrutyunjaya. Mrutyu is death. Jaya, conquer. So you can conquer death if you repeat this sloka. Trayambakam ejamahe sugandhim pushtivardhanam urvarukameva bandhanan mrutyor mukshiyam amrutat. That is the sloka. I see. So I can be deathless by reading this sloka. I don't think so. What is death? Desire is death. Desire is death. Attachment to body is death. Ego is death. So you can conquer death by being desireless. You can win over death by being egoless. But however, why is it called Mrutyunjaya, that you can conquer death? Why is it called so? Meaning, at least there will not be death before the schedule. Some of the flights reach airport half an hour before the scheduled time. When the flight scheduled time is 12, the aircraft may reach by 11 o'clock, 1 hour before. So some of the living creatures go to the other world before the schedule, meaning dying and at a young age. So this sloka at least will take us to destination the right time, if not before time. That's how also we can take it. And further, what does Baba say about it? O God, as I leave this world, let me leave this world in full knowledge of awareness, in full awareness of the self, in full experience of the self, just like a ripe fruit gets disconnected from the tree and falls on the ground. You follow me? Fruit falls on the ground automatically at maturity, painlessly, effortlessly, naturally, automatically, easily, instantaneously, painlessly. Am I right? Similarly, O God, as I leave this world, let me drop like a fully ripe fruit, easily, simply, effortlessly, joyfully, joyfully. There is no reason to cry for death, because death is celebration. When I change my dress, when I feel like wearing a nice suit, of course I like dark colored suits and all that, I don't cry when I wear the suit, do I? Not necessary. The dark blue suit I have, on special occasions I wear, you know. Particularly when Swami talks to doctors, international conferences. Swami also cuts a joke, oh, you are in suit now. Swami, I am an international fellow now. Because we have got doctors from all parts of the world, so I can't afford to be simply in Indian dress, okay. So when I change my dress, no reason to cry. We can be happy. Death is the dress of life. Death is the dress of life. So that's the meaning of Mrityunjaya Mantra. Question number 17. Question number 18. There is one Upanishad by name Taittiriya Upanishad. Taittiriya Upanishad. One, that's name of the Upanishad. Taittiri, what is it? That is the question. What is the etymological meaning of this word Taittiri? Answer. There lived a saint by name Yajnavalkya, a great saint. He has learnt all that, all the knowledge he vomited out. And all that he vomited out was eaten by birds, by name Taittiri birds. These birds, by taking all that which is vomited by the saint, started making sounds of this Upanishad. As all the sounds are repeated by the birds, by name Taittiri, it is called Taittiriya Upanishad. Am I clear, please? That's what it is. And question number 19. There is a very popular Upanishad by name Ishavasya Upanishad. Very popular Upanishad. In fact, the point is, most of the people want experiences, stories, miracles. Therefore, it is not giving enough of chance for us to go into the depth of the philosophy. Given to me, I want to read Upanishads. Left to me, I want to read Ramana Maharishi and his teachings. Left to me, I want to go into the depth of Brahma Sutras, like that. But people ask Manil Kumar, please tell me two latest miracles. I don't know what latest miracles are and outdated miracles look like. So, the Upanishadic literature is not very much received by ordinary people unless they are of some depth, some awakening. Rather, specially blessed by God. Yes. Ishavasya Upanishad is one such popular Upanishad. What is the first sloka of that Upanishad? Ishavachyamidam sarvam yatkincha jagatchan jagat chena chiktena bhunjidha ma gurudakasya siddhanam. That is the first sloka. What is its meaning? The whole universe is full of divinity. Thou shalt not covet others' property. Ma gurudha kasya siddhanam. Thou shalt not covet others' property, which is there in Ten Commandments. Am I not right? That's what says Ishavasya Upanishad. Question 20. There is one Upanishad which compares the human body with a car. What is that Upanishad? It is Katha Upanishad. Katha, K-A-T-H-A. Question number 21. Kathopanishad is the conversation between two people. Who are they? It is the conversation between a boy by name Nachiketa and the god of death by name Yama, Y-A-M-A. Nachiketa wanted to know the life after death, and Yama, the god of death, says, "My boy, why do you want to know life after death? You want kingdom? I'll give you." "No, sir, I want that knowledge." "You want money? I'll give you." "No, sir, I want that." "You want palaces?" "No, I want that." This fellow went on insisting, pestering Yama to teach him the science of the self. So ultimately he told him. So this Kathopanishad speaks of fundamentals of Vedanta philosophy taught by Yama, the god of death himself, to Nachiketa, an aspirant, a true aspirant, who could conquer Satan. Just as Satan tempted Jesus Christ, Yama tempted Nachiketa in every possible way, and he said, "Nothing doing, I want that knowledge only." So that's what it is. Then towards the end, he asked, very young boy, age 6 years, 6 years. "Are a boy, come here. Do you know Mantra Pushpam? Mantra Pushpam has got number of Sanskrit verses sung in praise of God. Mantra Pushpa, Pushpa means flower, Mantra, the flower of Mantra." So he asked that boy, 6 years boy, "Do you know what Mantra Pushpa?" "Yes, sir, Swami." "Oh, I say, what is it?" The boy said, "Antar bahischadat sarvam vyapya narayana sthitaha." "Swami, I know." "Oh, what do you know?" "God is inside, God is outside also. God is inside you, God is outside. God is everywhere. That the whole world is the very form of God, is the very manifestation, reflection of God. And this God is the energy for the sustenance, for the maintenance of the entire creation." 6 year old boy giving that answer. We were all dumbfounded that evening. This is a summary of all that had happened on 25th of October, there in Sai Kulwant Hall, Veda. This is yet to come in Telugu Sanatana Sarathi, while you could get it well in advance. This what happened on 30th of October, year 2003, 30th of October. On 30th of October, 2003, in the evening, there was a meeting. It was the valedictory function of the meeting of the vice chancellors. The vice chancellors of Indian universities had a symposium on human values, a 3-day program in the divine presence of Bhagwan. 30th was the concluding day, valedictory function. And three of them spoke, addressed the gathering, and that meeting was presided over Bhagwan. And three vice chancellors expressed their feelings about Sri Satya Institute of Higher Learning. "As devotees of Baba, we'll be very happy to know how his university is, how his children are." It is with that idea in mind, I recorded the speeches of all the three people and noted certain important points. This will come in Telugu Sanatana Sarathi later, sometime later, when they find some time. Well, this year happens to be the Golden Jubilee of University Grants Commission, New Delhi. University Grants Commission is the apex body which gives a recognition to all universities all over the country, which gives financial support to all the universities in this country. which rates the quality of teachers and students of every university. So University Grants Commission is the apex body in the field of education, a central government body, independent body, autonomous. This year happens to be the Golden Jubilee celebration, and the University Grants Commission wanted to have a symposium organized in Prashant Nilayam with the permission and blessings of Bhagwan Baba on value-oriented education. Swami said yes. So they had a three-day conference, 28th of October, 29th and 30th of October. 28th was inauguration, 30th was the valedictory function. So it is in that connection we had the valedictory function here. The first speaker happens to be one gentleman by name V.S. Prasad Rao. Prasad Rao, P-R-A-S-A-D-A-R-A-O, Prasad Rao is the first speaker. He is in charge of National Assessment and Accreditation Committee. It is the top body which rates every university, every lecturer, every degree, and which determines the standards. A supervisory body, not a small thing. That Prasad Rao, the first speaker, made certain important statements which will be of immense interest to all Sai devotees. What he said is this, point one. We, the Vice Chancellors, visited the whole university here. We went round all the departments. We visited hostel. We visited hospital. We visited Chaitanya Jyoti. We had been to all places of interest here in Prashant Nilayam. And we could also have opportunity to discuss with people in charge of these centers. Point number two. We, the Vice Chancellors, consider it a blessing, a greatest fortune given to us by Bhagwan Sri Satyasai Baba to have our conference in the Divine Presence. Point number three. We, the Vice Chancellors, have noticed the spirit of devotion, dedication and duty among the teachers, professors of this university. The Vice Chancellors have also observed discipline among students. As we visited the super speciality hospital, we could meet some of the former students of Satyasai Institute working there in the hospital. There we observed the former students, old students, practicing all the values which they have learned as students in the university. Next point. The NAC, the apex body of this country, recognizes this university with all its appreciation and calls this university the crest jewel of education in India. Crest jewel, that's what he said. Next point he said was, the education system adopted here in Sri Satya University is called integrated university, integrated education. What is integrated education? Integrated education means teaching of the values along with the regular curricula. As I teach physics, I simultaneously teach the values. As I teach biosciences, I blend the subject with the values. This is what's called integrated education, which is unique here in Swami's university. Sri Satya University has got a special course, what you call environmental science. Environmental science is present all over the world. But the environmental science here in this university has got a beautiful combination of value system also. Because by following values, you can preserve the purity of the environment. Environment can be made free from all sorts of pollution by practicing these values. This may be adopted by all universities all over the country. Prasad Rao finally said, all the Vice Chancellors request Bhagwan Sri Satyai Baba, the Chancellor of this university, to start National Institute of Excellence in Education in Human Values, so that this National Institute, to be started by Bhagwan Baba, should give training to all the professors all over the country in batches, so that they will learn what integrated education is, how to blend the curriculum with the human values, how to introduce values in the syllabus. So, Baba, we pray that you start a national institute. That's what he said. The second speaker is a lady, Professor K. Sudha Rao, S-U-D-H-A. She is the Vice Chancellor of Open University, Mysore, in the state of Karnataka, India. She made a brief speech, and these are the points. I see every person here in this institution not as an individual. Every individual here in this university is an institution himself. Every individual is an institution, not a single person. That is my observation. She also said, for the total development of human personality, the integrated education system which is followed here in this university is best suited and most ideal. She also said, we find values very much talked about all over the world. People speak of values, but here, according to Sudha Rao, the learned speaker, she observed the values being practiced in the daily life. She observed teachers and students talking to each other in their behavior, in their day-to-day routine. She observed people practicing the values, not simply spoken about. And she said, if the values are not practiced and simply spoken or taught, the values lose their real value. The values are practiced here in this university. Finally, she said, all this is because the location of this university, at an ideal place like this, far from the madding crowd, with Bhagwan Sri Satyai Baba as the Chancellor of this university. I thank Swami, the university professors, for their courtesy, invitation, generosity and hospitality extended to us. So saying, she concluded her talk. Now we have the third speaker. His name is Professor N. Jaya Shankaran, J-A-Y-A-S-A-N-K-A-R-A-N, Jaya Shankaran. He is the Vice Chancellor of Sri Chandra Sekhara Saraswati Viswa Mahavidyalaya, another university, located there in Kanchipuram, Tamil Nadu, Vice Chancellor. And the third speaker's speech was very well applauded, repeatedly cheered, and everyone liked. But I wanted to cover the other two speakers also, so I have jotted down. This is the gist of the third speaker. What he said is this: as I look at the huge gathering here, students, staff and devotees here, I see that each one here in this auditorium is a reflection of Bhagavan Sri Satyasai Baba and his bliss. That's what he said. Jayashankaran, a senior vice chancellor, he said, I participated in a number of symposia, seminars, discussions and conferences. For the first time, my voice is fumbling. My legs are trembling. You must have watched me drinking 5 glasses of water, because I am in the presence of the divinity, Bhagavan Sri Satyasai Baba. That makes me feel nervous. That's what he said. Further he said, on the previous day, that is 29th of October, 4 students spoke in 4 languages. Hindi, Sanskrit, Telugu, English. This vice chancellor spoke in appreciation of all the 4 speeches made by students in 4 different languages. There are certain very well known speakers in this country. Late Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, Lakshmana Swami Modaliyar, Rama Swami Modaliyar, Right Honorable Srinivasa Sastri, all over Tamil Nadu, they belong to Tamil Nadu. They are all very popular orators. British people appreciated their English. Some of them corrected British people, their pronunciation. Some of them have pointed at their grammatic mistakes. Born in India, could correct Britishers. You can imagine their scholarship in English language and literature. This Jayashankaran says, 4 students who spoke, they are going to be orators of that standard in the years to come. Further he said, all the vice chancellors here on the dais, I am sure, cannot make speeches of that standard. That's what he said. All the talent, skills of communication, the language, the feelings and the thoughts, all these things are the gifts of Bhagavan to students of this university. And the vice chancellor said, I request all students here to be the messengers of Sai, to be the propagators of Sai message all over the world. And he mentioned a small miracle. The daughter of his servant maid had a heart problem. That little girl was taken to Madras for treatment to Apollo Hospital there at Madras. After conducting all the tests, doctor said that she should be operated, surgery, which costs 3 lakhs only. You cannot expect a servant maid to spend so much of money, 3 lakhs. It's practically impossible. So the servant maid cried and cried as she was working in the house of this vice chancellor. The vice chancellor wanted to do something for this lady, the servant maid. He happened to go to Bangalore when Swami was there in the Whitefield. He went on official work, got the interview. There the interview, he said, Swami, I have got a request. What? My servant's maid daughter is suffering from heart problem, Swami. You should bless her. Is that so? He materialized vibhuti for her, called the director of the hospital, Dr. Safaya, gave instructions that this girl should be operated upon at the earliest. The girl was operated free of cost. Now 3 years passed, she is hale and healthy. Doctors gave her 3 months time, that's all. 3 years passed. We don't know the doctors are there or not, but she is quite hale and healthy. She is all right. And this Vaishyankar also recalls another incident. Along with him happened to be another person also called for an interview by Baba on that day. 3 years ago, he is from England. And that devotee from England was having a ring with 3 diamonds. He was already having. But it so happened, because of prolonged use for a very long time, the ring shape has changed. Symmetry has changed. And 1 diamond fell, is lost. That hopeless, shapeless ring he was wearing, Swami gently removed it. What sort of ring is this? Shape is gone. No diamonds. Swami, 1 fell down, what can... Is that so? 3 diamond rings, perfect new ring came there. Perfect 3 diamonds, damn new shining ring. Swami gave it to him, presented. This incident was recalled by the Vice Chancellor, which he shared with everybody. Further he said, Swami, we are very grateful to you because the kind of hospitality given to us is of the same standard as it is given to any marriage party, wedding party. We are treated as first class new bridegroom here, you see. Reception, wedding reception. Thank you very much. We enjoyed every minute. Further, this Vaishyankar said, all the Vaishyankars have not come here merely to attend a conference. This is a holy pilgrimage to all the Vice Chancellors to this place, Prashantranayam, what he said. He also commented, the serenity, the solemnity, the dignity, the sanctity, the peace and the silence that he observed here, he never experienced anywhere till now. And now, he concluded his speech with a beautiful remark. I am sure that all of you would burst into laughter. Swami, there are 300 universities in this country. This university is great because you are here. I pray that you be in 300 forms and exist in every university as the Vice Chancellor, as the Chancellor, so that other universities also can come up to this standard. Or else it is impossible to match your university. That was the final statement made by that gentleman. And he also said 2 points. Usually whenever vice chancellors or professors go to other places to attend conferences which are held in cities, they go for sightseeing. They go for sightseeing. They make some shopping to carry gifts to the family members. The Vice Chancellor says, this is the only place where Vice Chancellor sat all through the proceedings, because no shopping, nothing doing here. They were very serious. They took things very seriously. They had all seriousness of purpose, and they could do that. That's what he said. And the miracle of miracles is that all Vice Chancellors agreed on all the points, on all the resolutions arrived at towards the end. All resolutions are passed unanimously.